money to the, on other business. So much has happened in Zimbabwe, elections, and it's clear that Zimbabwe's economy remains currently under strain. There are liquidity shortages, renewed worries of inflation, and a diminishing delivery on social programs that are putting citizens under pressure and testing resilience. Professor Mutuli is extremely experienced in terms of finance. He was one of the founders of Investec. He's worked for a number of other companies. He was chief economist and vice president of the African Development Bank and has championed the bank's inclusive growth agenda. He's also served as dean and professor of finance at the University of Witwatersrand and was a lecturer in finance at the London School of Economics. I believe his PhD was from the University of Cambridge, University. So he's no stranger to the United Kingdom or indeed Chatham House. He's spoken here before in a different capacity. So, Professor Minister, I'm very grateful that you found time in this very, very intense schedule, flying in this morning and leaving this afternoon to come to Chatham House and to tell us about your plans for economic reform in Zimbabwe. The Minister will have a PowerPoint display, so we'll be showing that in a moment. Mr. The clicker is just here for you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you for inviting me to Chatham House. Colleagues, thank you for coming to listen to me and to hear this Zimbabwe story in terms of economic reforms, which is what I'll talk about in the next 15 to 20 minutes. And I guess there is
a quick Q&A
at some point. Let's see what comes up.
So basically,
that's better. So my talk is on the reform agenda in Zimbabwe, which covers both political or institutional and also economic reforms. And also we're very clear on the implementation mechanism. Sounds like central planning, but it isn't. And I mean tracking deliverables, making sure the targets have been met, calling those who haven't met the targets to account, or very, very serious about that. Certainly it is President Mnangagwa's style to make sure that there is performance. We have a vision called Vision 2030, which seeks to move Zimbabwe into an upper middle income country by year 2030, making sure that our GDP to capita is on the order of $3,500. $4,000 per person. At the moment, as of Friday, we announced the rebasing of our GDP. Zimbabwe is now a lower middle income country because the structure of the economy has changed. Service sector has grown, looking at telecoms, banking, and other sectors. It's about 20% of the economy. So it was necessary to rebase. It started before my time. My job was just to announce when you've been a minister for exactly 7 days. 1 month, and today is my birthday. So the transitional stabilization program that announced on Friday is just an implementation tool or set of policies for Vision 2030. Vision 2030 itself focuses on making sure that we respect the rule of law, we invest in infrastructure, we stabilize the economy, and we promote the notion of growth. Now, in terms of the reform package, the transitional stabilization program is going to basically stabilize the macroeconomy. No one wants to invest if the macroeconomy is not stable, out of kilter, returns cannot be anticipated sensibly, and risks cannot be hedged easily. So, macro stabilization is the first order of business. So we also have to institute certain institutional reforms around the ease of doing business, around the rule of law, around just making it easier for investors to invest. And just focusing on some quick wins on the project investment front. We've got some quick wins in terms of roads, for investment, power stations, and so forth. And the housing sector will focus on those. Let me start with fiscal reforms on the macro front. So the idea is for us to basically balance the budget. We need some fiscal discipline, reduce that budget deficit from the current two-digit level.
I won't say the figure exactly, because the next thing is going to be in the newspaper in Zimbabwe. It says the minister announced the budget deficit in London.
I did it. I just said it's double digit. We're determined that in the next year or two, it comes into lower single digit zone. It would be wonderful if next year we're sitting here and the deficit is around 5 to 7% of the GDP, and the 2020 is sitting at 3%. It would be wonderful if that is the case. And this work, I'm going to attack on two fronts. I've already started by increasing the tax base on the revenue raising front. On Monday last week, I introduced the electronic transactions tax of 2% per every transaction. And there are exemptions for pensioners, for wage payments, for tax payments. There are so many exemptions. We also put a cap on the maximum that can be paid by anyone, $10,000. If any transaction above $500,000 and above, the cap is $10,000. And below $10 per transaction, you don't pay any transactions tax. So that's how we've designed it in terms of expanding the tax base, because the economy has become informalized. And also to deal with tax evasion, that kind of tax is a top line tax as opposed to a bottom line tax. We know what happens in the bottom line. As a business before, employees find accountants, you're going to reduce your tax bill very easily if you do that. Then on the cost container in front, dealing with the civil service bill, dealing with state owned enterprises, I'll say a few things afterwards. That's why we're dealing with domestic savings and making sure that our exports are competitive. On domestic savings, just embedding the culture of maybe financial inclusion, pushing that agenda a lot more so that ordinary people also can begin to save. But also, we're desirous to launch a formal state pension fund. At the moment, the system is pay as you go, but it would be nice to launch a We will do that. Proper to launch a defined contribution or defined benefit scheme. We'll look at that and see how best to do it. Because as you know, one transfers the risk to the pensioner and the other, the risk is to us, the government. So we'll look at that as a way of deepening the savings. A few charts about the budget deficit. Now you know the figure, but don't broadcast it too much. The GDP forecast for this year is above what we expected. We're focused at 4.3%. Our outturn so far, we think, is going to be more like 6.4%, 6.3% at the end. In fact, the deficit itself, we want that to go down to the order of 3.8% by year 2021. So, lower single digit. I've talked about the carbon transaction tax rate. The wage bill is currently 18% of GDP. We want that to drop down to below 10%. We're targeted. Also, if the denominator grows, which is the economy, that will also reduce that number without doing anything about the much more numerator. Cut down on government waste, whether it's vehicles. I suspended purchase of vehicles for ministers and parliamentarians. But I think I'll resume in the not so distant future. Starting with parliamentarians, certainly the ministers will be last to get their vehicle, and I want to be the last to get my vehicle. I still need to travel, I can't walk away. Just to show that we're serious about cutting down on government waste. I've said a lot about the pension scheme, we're going to do that. I'm making sure that we can mobilize service and move the pension benefits to a more sustainable path. On the wage bill, containment measures is the usual thing. Freeze on uncritical pause and forcing retirement policy, vehicles I've talked about, maybe we're rationalizing some foreign ministers. Although we know that we need to do more in London, this is a very important mission here. So we need to invest more here than perhaps anywhere else in any of our commissions. And I've committed that to the ambassador. We will do that, sitting with my chair, my tenure. Thinking about the bonus payments at the end of the year, this will be very, very unpopular. I know that my colleagues, but we need to think about it. I won't be specific, but I know exactly what we will do is not to cut it off completely, but change the formula slightly. That will serve us $60 million, I know the figure. And then the starting of payroll controls. I'm going into detail here just to show that we do have a plan on how to deal with that. And then, you know, sorry for some of the technical detail on this. If you look at our treasury bill issuances, the market value, or maturity value of our treasury bills right now is it's about $9 billion. It's a lot of money. Because what was happening is that the budget deficit is being monetized, sorry for using it in common term, monetizing that. And that is also feeding into the exchange rate. It's not surprising that if you look at the, whether you're looking at the bond notes exchange rate, or they're looking at the RTGS balances, for those who know a little bit about the Zimbabwe currency, Zimbabwe currency regime, that deficit is also feeding into the valuations on that currency. But of course, there's speculative activity as well. So there is that. And I'm determined that agriculture becomes more smart, we get into a more sustainable financing model for that. And for the treasury bills, we make sure that they're subject to market-oriented mechanisms for better price discovery. And I know that just by doing that, I could save easily 200 basis points in terms of cost to treasury for those treasury. Looking at the finance sectors, again, we're determined to support different sectors. Before that, on the monetary policies to support the fiscal policy. So last week, again, we introduced foreign currency accounts. So now you should be able, as an exporter, to keep some of your proceeds in a specialized account, ring fence. We won't touch it, I promise. We will not touch that account. I don't think the past that promise has been reversed, not under my watch, certainly not me. I don't want your money, keep it. Just make sure we can account for it in our reserves, then we look good. That's what I care about, and not your money. Also, we're introducing other micro institutions for strengthening monetary policy, such as the proper monetary policy committee. We even instituted some action around mopping up liquidity from the market, the reserve requirement of 5% that we introduced, because we can't run standard inflation targeting. Sorry about the economics, we can't do that. So the only thing we can do is remove 5% of the deposits, sterilize them, so we don't cause inflation, which also is beginning to trigger. So we're not ready yet to do more than that on the monetary front, but we're moving in the right direction. We're going to build reserves, make sure that we get to at least 6 months import cover before we think of tracking serious steps such as introducing new currency or whatever. But we need to build reserves, including gold reserves, credit lines, and all that shit. With institutional measures, create the right conditions for the introduction of a new currency. So whatever we decide to do, whenever that happens. So I have no timetable for that. Now coming to the various sectors, again, we're determined to support the various sectors and do the right thing. Whether it sounds like industrial policy, but I think that in an economy that's trying to wake up and get out of a coma, you need to do that. Government needs to be there. You saw what happens in the financial crisis. Government had to be there to stimulate demand and do all manner of things in terms of expansion and fiscal policy, but within reason. So supporting agriculture, supporting industry, supporting mining, we're doing all of that and making sure that there's too many numbers in terms of sectors. But you can see that the sector where we're getting the biggest payoff, in my view, and we're looking at that, at least in the first 2 years, is mining. So anyone going to mining is going to help us a lot in terms of our GDP growth numbers. You can see we're projecting a 9%, 9.7% by year 2020. It sounds ambitious, but it's doable. Other countries have done it. Ghana this year's growth is close to about 9%. This and that's out. And then agriculture, you see mining. And then manufacturing has been laggard. You can see that's the prognosis right through 3 years. And then you expect stronger growth in construction. And then the hotels distribution and restaurants, that's going to pick up 2019, 2020. This is the tourism story. Yeah, absolutely. So we know which sectors to spend more time supporting, giving incentives for where we can, but at the end of the day, we want to get out of the way, let the private sector do everything, but do what we can in the beginning, get it on the right path. use the way smart agriculture, the issue we need to sort out in agriculture, just a more sustainable financing model for it that crowds in the private sector and that crowds out the private sector. So that's what we are working on. For example, one of the things that I've suggested is we start providing guarantees to financial institutions, provide credit for farmers because of the weak property rights around the land, which we're still sorting out in terms of 99-year leases. That's a way out rather than issuing treasury bills to finance agriculture directly, which has been happening in the past and partly explains the sharp increase. So we know what to do. And by the way, that went well as well because we have food security in Zimbabwe, and that's the upside. We have food security and importing less food. And so this did work as a way to ensure food security. El Nino is on the way. There's 60% chance of it happening. So that's a worry going forward. But I think on the grain fund, especially maize, we've got very good strategic reserves that will, I think will push us somewhere if this happens. I won't bother you with the detail of agriculture. Mining, as I say, great opportunity. If you speak to the Minister of Mines, he has a big, we could spend all day talking to you about mining sector. It's really exciting. Zimbabwe is easily 40% of the top minerals by value in the world. We have everything. I just tell my friends in South Africa, say them, I hope this is coming out, not in coming. And then I won't say anything. But anyway, let me put it another way to say, look, the solution to South Africa's mining profitability, viability issues is to invest in Zimbabwe. That's how you save jobs in South Africa, is to invest in Zimbabwe and making sure that those companies come across. Because first of all, we need that investment. Secondly, it will make South African mining more viable. Because it's shallow, you don't dig 3 kilometers in Zimbabwe, which is happening with gold mines. And I'm serious about this, not a joke. I actually think that strategy, that regional strategy, is the way to make sure that mining companies in South Africa also stay viable. Right? By investing nearby, up north in Zimbabwe. The one area where we need to spend more doing is the area of exploration. Zimbabwe is also underexplored. It's got lots of minerals, but it is underexplored. We need more exploration capital to come through. It's not easy to get risk capital. This Tower want to do a little bit more. They're also very good. They've done very well in the oil sector. I think they should expand their activities to drug areas. So we need to do more. We have everything. Lithium, whatever. It's just incredible. And this has unleashed various projects. For instance, if you look at the area near our home, traditional home area in the west of the country, we've got lots of coal bed methane gas. Already someone is planning with the government to build a fertilizer factory, produce ammonium nitrate, but also to produce a fuel from that gas using the Sasol type technology. All this is going to happen, we're very serious about it. So there's just so much incredible potential. I won't spend more time on that. For the industry, the challenge with the manufacturing sector is just the cost of, I happen to own a plastics factory for the record. And you cannot believe the trouble we have to get to be competitive. I produce buttons, to be clear. And the biggest challenge is competing with Chinese imports. Just simple buttons is a very competitive. And so the cost of output for us is high. Also the facts are our wages are high, our wage productivity ratio is too high. We're paying our employees in dollars like everyone else, but the productivity is not great. But certainly the machinery that is used right across industry, including some of mine, is old. So replacing, just retooling industry, if I can put it like that, is one of the biggest challenges for the sector. That's why the growth economy is exciting. But as government, it is our job to support it, to give incentives wherever we can, and certainly the Minister of Industry is part of that. Now, natural environment. And then the tourism is a great sector for us. All of you have been to Victoria Falls. If you haven't, please get across. We've had a very interesting Victoria Falls in the Eastern Highlands that you've never heard of. What is it called? You can see I don't even know it, but I know it's Mutarazi. Have you heard of Mutarazi? Anyone? I see a few nodes are getting better. So I'm just pointing out that there's just so much tourism potential in Zimbabwe and sure, on the digital economy, young Africans are great at coding, they just love this stuff. And supporting them is key. I've said a lot about the pension fund sector, government pension fund, banking is always high margin business for you to invest in. And I'm going to skip that. Now, on infrastructure, we have great projects on the infrastructure front. The Bulawayo, the Bybridge Harare Chirundu Highway, which I know a couple of people have won the contract. We should open it up, I don't know, because I haven't seen any movement. So I want to know what's going on. And that's a simple BOT type arrangement built on operate and transfer arrangement that we could do there over 30-year period, for example. Because government will never have enough capital to invest in it, so it is kind of like some of you are here. And you should look at that when we publicize this. And I always say that these projects must be publicized globally. Just advertise globally for partners. And maybe reduce some of the deals that we do under the table. It's tempting, but I think let's get other partners in there. This is Karima Dam. If you look at Patoka Gorge, that project seems to be forward in Zambia and Zimbabwe for producing hydropower. We have a wonderful partnership, GE Capital, Simon Hydro, doing that project. And we hope that will contribute quite a bit to our power demand in terms of the power supply. Now, the one exciting thing about that project, when I talk to the project promoters, is they want to make sure that some of the investors in the project are on that in Zimbabwe. So just issuing a simple retail bond, a project bond to ordinary Zimbabweans with a very good yield. It is a good thing for financial deepening, for financial inclusion. So I'm really encouraging them to do that. That is a good thing. So many infrastructure projects. We are going to invest in the 1-6, again, for additional power supply. I still need someone to look at the Zisco properly. I think that we could do better on Zisco as a potential for facility for producing coke. And I think the project has been too slow. If we just focus on that rather than steel, we may move faster. In that part of the Midlands, we've got one of the highest deposits of iron ore in the world. Huge potential. It's just incredible. And somehow, we're not getting things right. But we'll get there. So I've talked about 1.7 May, and this for the Pidgin. We just completed the Karima South expansion with the capacity of 30 megawatts. We're spending $10 million a month importing power from Eskom. It would be nice one day to stop that. And also Kahorabas in Mozambique, being self-sufficient in power, but also cheaper power. Urban water. Sanitation infrastructure with the outbreak of cholera. What I did when I came in, I launched a crowd fund. Of course, it went down very well in some quarters, but I think it didn't go down well with the diaspora. I said, "Oh, government taking so much money, now you're asking for money." People forget that a crowd fund is voluntary. You donate whatever you want to donate. If you don't want to donate, it's okay. So don't criticize me for taking money from you because you're giving voluntarily. So, but it's been very successful. Zimbabwe corporates, Zimbabwe citizens have donated a lot of money, which will go towards building infrastructure, for especially in Harare, clean water, and so forth. So that's very important, and we're going to invest more in that kind of urban infrastructure. But looking more nationally, there's just so many opportunities and projects in infrastructure. Marovanyati, Gwaishangan, project. There's just so much that could go on and on and on. It's just incredible. Talking about roads, I'm going to skip that. Housing, in my previous life, I spent a lot of time studying the middle class in Africa. And it's quite clear that one of the reasons why you have a strong middle class in places like Morocco, now mentioning your countries, governments are not supposed to mention your country, but I will, just to make Morocco, Tunisia, and so forth, is because of housing policy, because that's the quickest way of building a household balance sheet in an urban area. That's how we build a middle class and get property rights in the housing sector. So the more we do in the housing sector, Harare, it's great for building a middle class, then moving the whole country seriously into an upper middle income status. So investment in housing, I hope as investors in the room, you will find the opportunity in that sector and be able to invest in housing. But I must say that one thing we need to do in housing is to densify. This idea that you build a small house on a large piece of land is not a good idea, because then the cost of bulk services, the road, the water, is just more expensive to provide those services if you have low density. So what you really need is two or three story type accommodation. You densify, then the cost of bulk services is manageable. On the education front, and we're very serious about reforms on the education front. I have agreed with the Minister of Higher Education, for example, that government should only pay salaries for university lecturers, professors, and not for the buildings. All the buildings will be funded through some kind of public-private partnerships, BOT structure. It is beginning to happen like that. And if you do that, then you can pay the professors a lot more than they are currently earning, and then be able to retain quality people and so on. So we're very serious about that. But also focusing on the skills element of education. There is nothing wrong with the Swiss and German model of education, where teenagers bifurcate at the age of 16, and they do some vocational stuff. Because, you know, easily 80% of youngsters in Switzerland go through the vocational route and not directly through the hard education towards a university. So that's something that we're investigating further. Already we've started, and most of the universities in Zimbabwe now, they're doing four-year degrees with the third year as an internship year, in terms of spending industry, learning some, getting some skills. But this needs to be embedded more, and that's what we're working on, to strengthen that skills element in the education sector. I'm going to say a bit about health, and then the empowerment here is we're serious about gender equity. We have to make sure that half the population is firmly included in our development And then in the ease of doing business, we're establishing a one-stop investment a facility called ZIDA. The bill is just under the principles that were approved last week. To Parliament soon, but we'd like to improve in every aspect of this. These are just readiness, you know, whether it's starting a business or getting electricity. You can see we're struggling here. Oh, this is good, 89, that's where we're struggling. Resolving insolvency, 155, enforcing contract. So these are areas that we need to sort out, and then we're getting electricity. You're doing great on those rankings. So we know the areas where we should impact to improve our environment and rankings of doing business. We are working on it, but the first order of business is establish the one-stop shop, and we're certainly going to make it happen soon. In terms of the legislative agenda, again, about 40 different pieces of legislation that are going to be revised, introduced, changed. We're very serious about it. Parliament is going to be very busy. For me, directly, it's going to be something around pensions, as you can imagine, and also the Public Finance Management Act. The Constitution says that we must implement decentralization or devolution, where we give more power to the district, provinces, and so forth, and I must transfer 5% of the budget to the districts. I'm going to do that. I'm bound by the Constitution, but do they have capacity to manage those resources, or to build that capacity, making sure that the systems extend all the way down, they know how to work within the systems, the officials down the provinces. So we will work on all of that, but we're going to be very, very, very busy in the next 2 years getting all this through Parliament. Absolutely. And then public enterprises. This has been an area of drain for public coffers. I think last year we was it about almost 500 million in the last 2 years supporting enterprises that are struggling. We need to move fast.
Want to privatize 11 state enterprises
quick. I've given some of them 6 months just to get on with it.
Absolutely.
And then six subsidiaries of the Industrial Development Corporation.
Also, those should privatize. And the mining, the MBC mining subsidiaries. The telecoms companies, PSP, within 6 to 9 months, I need to see progress. We need to see conclusion of privatization deals.
Absolutely. And I'm sitting on this case to make sure it happens.
And those that need to be liquidated will liquidate. Two-state enterprises will liquidate. If you know, 11 will merge, 7 will be departmentalized, 9 ministries, and so forth.
The list is long. So we're very serious about privatization. We've done it.
And the analysis is what is privatized, and these need to go and go fast.
What we may end up doing is, in case we have a liability with all the pensions fund, we may actually use some of these to capitalize the government pension fund that I mentioned earlier. But we'll see, it's just an option. I've talked about monetary reforms. And then maybe this is almost last on arrears clears. And so basically one of the key issues in our macro stabilization program is to clear the balances that we owe the African Development Bank, the World Bank, and then the bilateral partners, UK and everyone, so-called Paris Club, including the European Investment Bank. That's one of the reasons why I'm going to Bali tonight, to the World Bank and meetings, to continue our negotiations around the areas and clearance. So the idea obviously is to clear the World Bank and the FDB first, get that out of the way, and then tackle. But it's almost simultaneous, really, because the same shareholders tackle the Paris Club shareholders. But of course, first of all, we have to build trust with the bilateral partners, with the institutions, so that's part of the process. And building that trust is to show that we're serious about the reforms. The reforms are credible, we'll follow through. I must hesitate to say that on the political front, we are going to get rid, remove POSA. We're also going to remove AIPA, for the record. And that's a big change that we're going to do. You know what President Mnangagwa did after the unfortunate incident of the 1st of August, when he put in place this commission to try to understand the nature of violence that took place, where people lost their lives, what really happened, who's behind it, what are the recommendations, what are the findings. It's a committee of serious people, this commission of inquiry. These people who have their reputation at stake. I cannot imagine that whatever they recommend would be anything short of their current reputations, I suspect. It's going to be credible finding that we have to follow. The government is committed to making sure that we do what they suggest. So I'm pretty pleased with the progress on the political front. Even the elections, let's be honest, the elections were peaceful. They were just peaceful, except for this incident on the 1st of August. Now, regarding our relations with the IMF, those are good relations. They visited Zimbabwe last week. They're coming back for Article 4 sometime in the 7th of November, I think. And then I've requested that they do a we come on to a 6-month staff contact program, SNP. It's also a requirement for the arrears clearance, so that we have some other, let me call it an agent of restraint from outside to make sure that we stay on the reforms that we would like to implement and meet our targets. So all of this is part of the arrears clearance plan, where they talk about the political reforms, whether it's the relation with Ireland. And the troubling thing is for us is this pari passu rule, which says that we have to clear the FDB and the World Bank arrears simultaneously. That's a lot of money. That's well over $2 billion, which we have to find to clear both. But we're negotiating for this pari passu rule to be more elastic, so we can clear the smaller one first, which is the FDB, and maybe a couple of months, I don't know, and then clear the World Bank. So we have a plan, we have an idea, but I must say that in the end, the idea of plan for Zimbabwe will be ad hoc. It will be custom made. I think it will be similar to the Myanmar one, where Japan was the sponsor. So even for us, we need a sponsor to make things happen, then cajole the rest of the club for that instruction. So I think I'm running out of time. Last word on land. We love agriculture in Zimbabwe, as you know. So, but we are committed to the to what we did in the what is in the constitution, which is pay the farmers off. We need to pay the farmers off. The issue is just pricing of that land and improvements. We've done our own analysis where the price, bear the price, we negotiate and meet somewhere halfway. Whatever it is, we're committed to paying that. But also want to recognize that while that is a liability, we also have the asset as land. So one idea that we have, and this is an idea, a proposal, there are many ways to do this, of course, we'll evaluate all the options. But it's just to create a special purpose vehicle, some kind of land bank, where you throw in the land as an asset, the value, and the liability as payments to farmers. And suddenly we have a balance sheet. We have a balance sheet in the special purpose vehicle, this land bank. And then you can remove everything, both as a liability, out of treasury, and then suddenly the liability to the farmers is gone into this other institution. That's one way to deal with it. The other, of course, is to include the liability maybe in the foreign debt. So when we do the Paris Club negotiations, some of it is then restructured. They were looking at all those options, but we're determined to deal with this conversation. I thank you.
Minister, thank you very much. Let's just get straight into questions.